Hi everyone, today I'm going to be talking about the best winningest sports team in all of North America. Now some might say it is the Montreal Canadiens, the Boston Celtics, the San Antonio Spurs, and even the New York Yankees, but none of them are actually right. The most winningest sports team in North America is the Edmonton Grads. Have you ever heard of it? Probably not. The Edmonton Grads were a women's basketball team based out of Edmonton, Alberta, Canada that reigned from 1914 to 1940. Now, if you are a fellow millennial Canadian, you'll probably have an idea of what Heritage Minutes are. Lately, the Heritage Minute Canadian government has been really up in their game and bringing out some new really cool Heritage Minutes, including one on the Edmonton Grads. It features the team winning the Underwood International Trophy in 1923 against the favorites to win the Cleveland Favorite Knits, and details their winning streak for the next 20 years. So today I'm going to be talking about the team, talking about their reign, their kind of stats and their wins, how important they are not just in sports history but also North American history and women's sport history as well. But first I'm going to talk about the coach and how the team actually got started. In 1891, a Canadian by the name of James Naismith, who was working in the United States at a YMCA, invented the game of basketball. In the early 1890s, the YWCA and the YMCA started playing this game of basketball throughout its different clubs in North America, in the US and in Canada. Very early basketball in Canada was usually localized in Ontario just due to its proximity to the states and how a lot of those main centers were kind of all in one area, and people would often, when they started making some club teams, they would play people in the states just kind of across the border. Eventually, in the early 1900s and the 1910s, it makes its way to Alberta, and both men and women start playing it in their various clubs, organizations, and schools. In 1914, a girls' basketball team was created at the McDougall Commercial High School and was coached by Percy Page. That same year, they would win their first provincial championships and went to create a club team that was called the Commercial Graduates Basketball Club, were later nicknamed the Grads. Now, this commercial club team and this high school team were both coached by Percy Page, and they essentially created a system where successful high school players would level up to what was called the graduates, and then they would kind of learn, develop technique, get a little bit better, and then they would further level up to the grads commercial club. Now, this was a really key part of their success, as essentially it created this tier system where players could slowly get better and better as they aged, and they had a kind of like desire to advance and get better in their sport. Now, the team that were all coached by Percy Page really focused on a lot of passing, a lot of teamwork, and a lot of creative plays that really helped them in their success as well, which made them a little bit different from how other people were playing the sport. Now, Page throughout his coaching career was really, really loved by all the girls that he coached and all the people that he coached any form of basketball too. They loved him as a leader. He was very creative when it came to basketball. He was very smart about it. And so there was a really, really good bond between coach and player, which of course also helped in their success. And Percy Page was also very dedicated to basketball and having the girls' team succeed. He's even quoted as saying to the girls, "You must play basketball, think basketball, and dream basketball," to his various teams that he coached. Now, the girls only practiced 2 times a week between June and September. This was a lot of the time due to most of them had full-time jobs or some form of jobs or were still in high school or going to schools elsewhere. Now, Paige wanted them to be ladies first and basketball players second, and had kind of like a code of conduct for all these women who were competing with them in their sport. And remember, this is in the 1920s, so a lot of this sounds a little bit unfair, really. Now, he wanted to promote ladylike behavior, which included dressing appropriately, acting like a lady on and off the court. Acting like a lady off the court. There was no smoking, no drinking, and no bad company were allowed to be present. And a lot of this also came too with Percy's wife, who was the girl's chaperone, who would travel with them. They were never really allowed to be kind of on their own without some form of older woman as a chaperone, who tended to be married as well. And usually around this time as well, as soon as a woman got married, she was expected to stay home, take care of the kids, raise them, and take care of the household, and leave their jobs. Now, many of these women had jobs. There were a few women who, once they did get married, they left the team, but there were also a few who continued to stay on and play even after they were married. Now I'm gonna prove to you why they are the most winningest team in North American sports history. So I'm just gonna give you a whole bunch of stats of their success, how many championships they won, how long they held those championships, in order to prove that yes, they are the most winningest sports team. Now the Grads had over 25 years of success in the basketball community, a lot of the time winning multiple trophies back to back. Also, they beat a lot of their teams with a lot of very lopsided scores, as I will tell you about in a minute as well. So I'm gonna get started with their stats. Now in 1915, they won their first provincial championship in Alberta, and they won the next 23 out of those 24 titles. Within 25 years, they were provincial champions 24 times. In 1922, they won their first Canadian national championship when they beat the London Shamrocks from Ontario. Now this title they would hold until 1940, which is lasts about 18 years. So they won 18 national championships in a row. As I mentioned earlier, the first year that they won the Underwood International Trophy was in 1923 against the Cleveland Favorite Knits. They would hold this title until 1940, which is another 17 years of consistently winning each of these championships. And when they won again in 1940, the organizers of the Underwood International Tournament just gave them the trophy, because they knew if they ever played it again, they would probably end up keeping it and winning it. Now, during the Western Canadian Championships, which include Alberta, BC, and Saskatchewan, they won not just every year, but every game that they played during the tournaments. So they played in these tournaments from 1926 to 1940 of 14 years. So that's 14 championships and numerous games that they won. They did not lose anything during that 14 years in the Western Canadian championships. In 1928, as part of an exhibition for the Olympic Games, they beat a team in Paris 102-20. Participated in the Olympic Summer Games in 1925, 1926, and 1936, where they won basically every game they played as well. So they would have been Olympic champions three times. However, women's basketball was considered an exhibition sport and not an official sport on the Olympic roster at the time. Women's basketball wasn't actually an official sport at the Olympic Games until 1976. They were also world champions from 1937 to 1940, where again, they won every game that they ever played during those championship tournaments. Also competed against local and international men's teams, from what I can gather, about 9 times, and they actually won 7 of those games. Now, not only were these girls pretty incredible at basketball, but people also loved coming to watch them. Everywhere they went, wherever they played, they would fill stadiums because of their rather insane winning streak and how good they were at the sport. The Grads actually made international headlines in the UK, Cuba, the United States, and even in Hong Kong. Their highest back-to-back winning streak is actually over 100 games, just in a season between June and September. I believe that they played about over 400 games total throughout their entire career, and they only lost about 20 of them. Now, there are higher numbers out there, such as, I think, exactly 522 games. However, it's believed that some of those games were where they played against kind of their like gradettes and grads teams as kind of like for more of a practicing, or playing against like other men's teams as well, just to kind of warm up, really get them going, get them ready to go for their other events. With all these stats I have just mentioned, this gives them a winning percentage throughout their 20 or so years of competing at 95%. So by the time of their disbandment in 1940, they had held over 108 local, provincial, national, international titles, and had been untested world champions for 17 years in a row. Now, all of this is also considered the fact that in the 1930s, a lot of people believed that sports were far too strenuous for women, and also they weren't appropriate for them to be participating in. Now, a lot of people saw women competing in sports as a risk to their bodies and had many moral implications. However, the Edmonton Grads were able to combat this and show that they could be ladylike off the court and also get down and dirty on the basketball court and shoot some hoops. They became incredible role models for many girls and other women who thought that maybe participating in sport may be not too great for their selves morally or not too great for their bodies. No, if they were jumping around, things were not gonna fall out of their bodies. Obviously, you can see that these women are playing basketball and nothing's falling out. They're not crazy, they're not sick, they're not injured. So it was fine to compete just in sport and to do things. And so it also showed that women can be successful athletically as well. Now, unfortunately, all amazing winning streaks do eventually come to an end, and the end came for the grads around 1940. For a team that had such an incredible, amazing winning streak that brought spectators and fans from all over the world to watch, why would they, kind of in the height of their careers, stop playing basketball? Now, at the time, there was little competition for them, and it gradually became harder and harder to find teams to play against. And a lot of these people, you can only play against someone so many times and get beat down so many times before you just don't want to play against them anymore, which is totally fair. Now, another thing was that there was a couple different rules that were out there, different kinds of basketball, different rules for men and women, which made it a little bit difficult to find something that was very standardized, that had a complete set of rules, or had rules that you had to adjust to or make new ones, that sort of thing. Also, after the 1936 Olympic Games in Berlin, it made it a lot more difficult to travel internationally because the world was literally about to blow up in like 3 years. So there's a lot of tensions going on. There's a lot of things that were kind of slowly fighting against them at this point. Then in 1939, World War II starts. So in 1939, the Royal Canadian Air Force took over their home arena as the Second World War had just started. Now, with the men off to war, women were sent into factories and other places to do jobs that men were no longer around for. So this really restricted their time and place where they could actually train and participate and play games. However, they did try and keep the team alive for a little bit. They bounced around to different arenas, worked around work schedules, and tried to continue practicing for a little while. However, they never really stayed in one place for too long because normally the government would take over any form of large space and use it for housing soldiers, munitions, that sort of thing. So eventually, they didn't really have a place to train anymore either. So the coach, Percy Page, was also called to work for the government for the war effort in 1940. And with that, there was no coach, nowhere to practice, there was no women to play, and no people to play against. And with that, the team disbanded in 1940. Now, as for the team's legacy, unfortunately, it's not a team that you hear too much about because it's not a team that's around currently anymore. They haven't been around for 80 years. However, they still hold this record of a 95% winning streak. They won 95% of their games. So why don't we hear about them that much anymore? For one, it's probably because they're a women's team. We're just gonna put that out there. That's probably one of the reasons we don't hear about them. They're also a small team in Canada, so a lot of people don't really pay attention to a league that's no longer around anymore, that was a small team in Canada that just have the spectators that the NBA or WNBA does at this point in time. The team's record and success were so well known, not just in the basketball world, but internationally and worldwide during their kind of heyday. Even James Naismith had something to say about the team, and he's quoted as saying this in 1936. So you are not only an inspiration to basketball players throughout the world, but a model to all girls teams. Your attitude and success have been a source of gratification, not just for me, illustrating the possibilities of the game in the development of the highest type of womanhood. Has later said this as well. The grads are the finest basketball team to have ever stepped out on a basketball floor. Getting so much high praise from the person who actually invented the sport, you gotta be really, really good at the sport. And if he's saying that this is exactly what kind of possibilities he was looking for in a team to succeed and do and create, I know they did good, these girls. They did good. I'm also going to point out that this team was also incredibly successful during a very hard time for a lot of people in history, the Great Depression. These women were able to compete, play, bring people out, come to watch them, and do all this stuff during the Great Depression, where a lot of people didn't have work, a lot of people didn't have things to do, a lot of people were homeless, didn't have any money, but people wanted to go and see these women compete. Here in 1983, the Canada Basketball Hall of Fame added the entire roster of the 38 women who had ever played on the team to their Hall of Fame. And later in 2017, the Canadian Sports Hall of Fame inducted the Edmonton Grads into their Hall of Fame as well. So even now, they still have a huge impact on not just Canadian basketball, but Canadian sport. And that is the conclusion of the most winningest sports team in North America. The surprising women's basketball team is the best in North America. Not all these men's teams, it's a woman's team from Alberta. So thank you guys for sticking around. I hope you really enjoyed this video. I know I had a lot of fun doing a lot of research and was really inspired to continue doing more stuff about women's history, especially in Canada, because I'd kind of known about these guys, but not actually how good they were. So if you like this video, please give it a thumbs up. If you think of some other women's sport history, Olympic history, theme or topic you'd like me to research and discuss, please let me know in the comments. And if you like these videos, you can subscribe. I try if I remember to post every second week, so I think I'm doing well so far. Thanks, bye.